On this edition of The Fifth Estate, the voices in his head were unrelenting.
And what was it that you heard?
Like just people talking in the background about all different kinds of stuff, about me.
To silence the voices, he chose a target.
You knew he was a former hockey player.
Yeah, it's not no beef with him or his family. He just happened to be in the wrong place at the wrong time.
He admits he pulled the trigger.
Okay, I shot Brian Smith.
He ripped a hole through my soul. So how do you forgive that?
But Jeffrey Arenburg was declared to be not criminally responsible for Smith's death.
And I left there and I was like, where was I? What just happened?
His name is written large in a list of infamous offenders deemed NCR. Their victims, a stranger on a bus, a police officer on patrol, a young daughter and son.
I will always feel in danger, always, because I know this man, and he killed two children, you know?
And each case resulted in that controversial verdict, not criminally responsible. Ahead, the crucial question in the NCR debate. What happens when people like Jeffrey Arenburg get out?
You believe that? That had you gone to prison for Brian Smith's death, it would be different?
If I went to, you know where I'd be? In jail. So you want me in jail? Throw me in jail. I haven't got the authority anyway. So as far as I'm concerned, to you, for that comment.
Hello, I'm Bob McKeown. Welcome to the Fifth Estate. It is at the top of the federal government's law and order agenda. Legislation to toughen the section of the criminal code that allows those who commit violent acts, even killing someone, to be found not criminally responsible for reasons of mental illness. It means they go not to prison, but to a psychiatric facility, and that instead of a sentence of up to life behind bars, they could be released into the community in as little as a few years, if and when they're found to have recovered. Now, the government wants so-called high-risk NCR cases to face longer mandatory treatment. The question, is it for reasons of public safety or public opinion? You be the judge, as we give you an unprecedented view of a person whose life, for better or worse, has been defined by those three letters, NCR.
His name is Jeffrey Arenburg. He lives in a small room in a small city in Nova Scotia, surviving on a disability pension, spending hours daily on a laptop with no internet connection. He may not look it, but there was a time when Jeffrey Arenburg was the central figure in a story that made headlines across the country and beyond. Now, for the first time, he tells his story to us. He started out a farm boy from Bridgewater, a ninth grade dropout turned scallop fisherman along Nova Scotia's South Shore.
And that sounds like a tough job.
It is. It,
physically?
Well, yeah, what they call is a strong body and a weak mind. That's what you call fishing.
But then in his early 30s, Arenburg broke his back in an accident. He spent months in traction, no longer able to work the boats or even to walk.
I was in the hospital, I had to learn to walk all over again.
Yeah.
To this day, he can't move around without a cane. It was about the same time as the accident that Jeffrey Arenburg started hearing the voices wherever he went, the voices of others telling him what to do.
And what was it that you heard?
Like just people talking in the background about all different kinds of stuff, about me.
Saying what about you?
You name it, they said it.
Yeah, give me an example.
Like say if I went across town, then it'd be people talking, do this, do that, do something else, whatever.
Did you know who was telling you these things, whose voices they were?
It could have been your voice or somebody I see it on TV or anybody I met along the street that I talked to.
Arenburg says not only did he hear those voices speaking to him, but his own thoughts also were being transmitted by local radio stations, sharing his secrets with the world.
So at that point, if you were hearing the voices, what could you do about it?
Well, that's the thing. What could I do about it?
And those voices he heard started to cause trouble in his life. In the early to mid-90s, moving back and forth from Nova Scotia to Ottawa, where he went to school, Arenburg was well known to the justice and mental health authorities. He threatened violence if radio stations continued to broadcast his thoughts and was convicted of assault for attacking a radio station employee. He disrupted court proceedings, demanding judges order the voices he heard be stopped. If not, he warned, he might kill someone. But though he spent time in psychiatric hospitals, he was always released, and the voices kept coming back.
Security on Parliament Hill was even on alert for Arenburg after he attempted to enter the center block a number of times. He wanted to persuade the Prime Minister to use his influence to eliminate the voices and transmissions. It all came to a head in the summer of 1995. Arenburg was living in downtown Ottawa. He had recently brought something back from the Maritimes, something deadly. A .22 caliber rifle.
So you thought you needed it to protect yourself because of all of that?
No, to prove a point. Like, I have a right to a life without everybody being told what to think around me.
On August 1st, at Ottawa's CJOH television, fate was about to throw together two very different men who had never met.
Skating usually associated in the summer months.
Inside, just finishing the evening news, was the station's sportscaster, Brian Smith, from a well-known Ottawa family.
Left wing, Brian Smith, was one of the original Los Angeles Kings.
Smith played in the NHL with the LA Kings before coming home to work on TV, one of the Capitals' favorite sons. Just before 7 p.m., Jeffrey Arenburg was waiting outside. He says all he wanted was to tell the world about the voices controlling his life and to make them stop.
Do I understand you correctly, because you wanted to draw attention to what was happening in your
mind? Yeah, yeah.
Did you think about the right and the wrong of it at that point?
Yeah, but what's right and wrong when I don't have a right to a life? And people tell me this. Other people have heard the same voices. Mm-hmm. How am I supposed to do anything about it?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? How do you prove a point? How would you go about it?
Brian Smith had nothing to do with those voices, but as he stepped from the building, Arenburg was in the parking lot with a gun and a point to make.
So how did you use the gun to make the point?
Okay, I shot Brian Smith.
Jeffrey Arenburg pulled the trigger. A .22 caliber bullet slammed into Brian Smith's forehead. Smith's wife, Alana Keynes, was a reporter at the Ottawa Citizen. At that moment in the newsroom, she heard something unusual unfold on the police radio scanner.
So I'm listening, and I know when things are not just a backfire. I know when it's really serious. And so I'm heading towards the scanner, wondering what's happening.
When Keynes tried calling her husband, there was no answer.
I get an emergency call. And I said, is it him? What's going on? And they actually quite lied to me, but in a good way, so I could be safe. And they said, no, he's fine. But it was him.
No.
It was him.
Here, okay?
Okay.
Do you
need
me to take
care? Yeah.
For the next 24 hours, CJOH would report a story as awful and as close to home as it could
get. Let's just go. Do you have a car here?
Okay, good morning. CJOH sports director Brian Smith is clinging to life this morning, the victim of a gunshot wound to the head.
When he was ultimately taken off life support, he was mourned by all of Ottawa. Brian Smith's life was over. But the disturbing saga of his killer, Jeffrey Arenburg, had just begun.
This is a man who stole a great man from me, from his mother, who was never the same. from a community that's never really been the same. Yeah, he stole. He ripped a hole through my soul. So how do you forgive that? How do you think about that? But at the same time, I understand it was mental illness, and hopefully he's on the right road now, and he's not hurting anybody else.
But that remains to be seen. And this tragic story seems all the more senseless when told by the man who caused it.
Why Brian Smith?
He just happened to be the one walking out at that time.
Did you know who he was?
Yeah, from watching the news, yeah.
You knew he was a former hockey player?
Yeah, it's not no beef with him or his family. He just happened to be in the wrong place at the wrong time.
Well, his wife, Alana, would not characterize it quite that way.
Yeah, I know.
She says her life was profoundly changed by you pulling the trigger and killing her husband.
Yeah, like it's nothing against her or her family, like I just said.
Yeah.
It was to draw attention to all this fucking bullshit that was messed up my life.
The day after he shot Brian Smith, Jeffrey Arenburg turned himself in to the police.
Do you have girlfriends or anything like that here?
In an interview room at police headquarters, he's questioned by Ottawa detectives.
Do you have any close family at all?
Not here, no.
Arenburg is adamant he did what he had to do to publicly reveal the voices he believed were haunting him and others.
Well, I can't get it before the courts because no one listened to me. If everybody had equal rights to the law, shit like wouldn't happen. That's all I got to say about it.
It seems to take a while for the interrogator to catch on to his suspect's state of mind. Listen as Arenburg tries to get the officer to acknowledge he hears voices too.
Do you hear people talking in the background over a low frequency?
Sometimes when I'm on my boat and I got the radio on.
No, well, you know what I mean? That it don't actually come from the radio, but it's like in the background.
Are you talking like sort of in your subconscious sort of type of thing?
Well,
I don't want to put words in your mouth.
I'm trying to ask you a question. Do you hear people talking in the background that's not on, that doesn't come from a radio or a TV?
Well, if there are other people in the room, I may hear them talking.
No, it's through the airwaves somewhere. So, see, that's the same reaction I get wherever I go.
Well, it's not really
crazy.
Jeffrey Arenburg remained in custody as psychiatrists tried to assess whether, as he put it, he was crazy when he shot Brian Smith. Under medication, the voices he'd been hearing stopped. But when he stopped taking his meds, the voices started again. Finally, after almost 2 years, in April 1997, he was found fit to stand trial, charged with first-degree murder. The court had to address two questions. Did Arenburg have the mental capacity to comprehend the violent act he committed? And did he understand it was wrong? The judge, prosecutors, and defense all agreed both answers were no. He was found NCR for the death of Brian Smith.
Basically, the prosecutor told me that's what we're going to end up with. Right. So.
And could you accept that at the time?
I did at the time. Now I sometimes think differently. Because he'd still be treated to this day if he was in jail. No
longer. Alana Kane says she wonders if prison might have been a better place for him all along. Saying that if people
still need. And maybe that's where a Jeffrey Arenburg belongs, you know. And I didn't see him getting better. I didn't. In fact, I think he was at his worst when they let him go, you know. He was at his worst.
After the break, the years of scrutiny and suspicion that followed. And a crucial question, what happens in this and other cases when an NCR offender gets out?
I will always feel in danger, always, because I know this man. I know that, and he killed two children, you know?
In It's a family that seemed to be picture perfect. Two beautiful kids, three-year-old Anne-Sophie and her five-year-old brother Olivier. A cozy home in Quebec's Laurentian Mountains. Vacations on the beach in Cuba. And doting parents, Father Guy Turcotte, the cardiologist. And mother Isabelle Gaston. She's a specialist in emergency medicine. Dr. Gaston says her children have always been her pride and joy.
I see them smiling. I see them running, singing. All the time, every day of my life, yeah.
But a few years ago, the seemingly perfect marriage began to crumble. Gaston and her husband separated. One winter night in 2009, Guy Turcotte had the kids. Apparently distraught at the prospect of divorce, he decided to kill himself. Methodically, he called his mother to say goodbye. He canceled his medical appointments for the next day. And he sent his wife an email that read, "If you want war, you'll have war." Turcotte drank a liter of windshield washer fluid. Then he turned to the children. He stabbed his three-year-old daughter and five-year-old son. Between them, 46 times.
Why this happened to me?
Isabelle Gaston says ever since there's been the endless grief and second-guessing.
You feel at the point that, should I have done this? Should I have done that? Would have it changed a thing? Yeah, I think it's a normal part of the grieving process to feel sad, to feel mad, to feel, maybe you should have done things differently.
Charged with first-degree murder, Guy Turcotte went to trial in April of 2011. The seemingly deliberate crime generated national outrage. But in Quebec, Turcotte, like Paul Bernardo or Russell Williams, became a household name, the doctor who killed his kids. As an emergency room physician, Isabelle Gaston was well aware of the ravages of mental illness. But she says it was only when the trial started that it dawned on her Turcotte's lawyers might be paving the way for him to be declared not criminally responsible.
I think that NCR has its place, okay? I think it's unfair of someone that is really psychotic, okay, going to jail. But the thing is that we didn't think that people are so intelligent that they could manipulate the law and get this verdict when they should not have it.
Guy Turcotte had not previously been diagnosed with mental illness, and at trial, his defense team never claimed he suffered from it. His lawyers did argue he was so devastated by the breakup that he drank the windshield washer fluid and was severely inebriated when he stabbed his children. Their expert witnesses denied he could have understood what he did or the consequences, and the judge allowed the jury to consider a verdict of NCR, which is exactly what they did, declaring Guy Turcotte not criminally responsible for killing his daughter and son.
First of all, I wasn't shocked, okay? Yeah. You have to understand that I wasn't shocked.
Isabelle Gaston believes the defense strategy was to win the sympathy of the jury and the NCR verdict by blaming the deaths on the marriage breakup and blaming the breakup on her.
For me, this verdict was like saying you're the one that is responsible of killing your children. For me, this verdict was when the jury believed that he was sick. It's the separation that made him sick. Who decided to separate herself from her husband is you. So you're the only one that is responsible.
Especially in Quebec, the outcome of the trial was a sensation. The implicit question, did Guy Turcotte use NCR to get away with murder? After the verdict, he was sent to the Pinel Institute, Montreal's foremost psychiatric facility, for treatment. And just 18 months later, in December 2012, The Quebec Review Board, which oversees NCR cases in the province, ruled that Turcotte was sufficiently recovered to be released.
I think our system works very well.
Do you think the Turcotte case was an example of it working well?
Perfectly. Yes.
Dr. Louis Morissette is a Montreal psychiatrist who was not involved in the Turcotte trial. However, he was one of the medical experts who recommended Guy Turcotte be discharged from treatment.
Is he at risk of committing another crime? That's the point that we should ask. And from all the indications that we have, the level of the level of recidivism or the risk of him committing another crime is very, 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 very low. Cannot be zero because he did commit a horrible crime. But I understand that the Madame Gascon or people close to the family, it's terrible. But emotions should not prevent us from using what is available scientifically to evaluate the risk.
But Isabelle Gaston disagrees. She maintains that after a decade of marriage, she knows Guy Turcotte better than anyone, and that a few years of medication and therapy aren't enough to address what he did.
I will always feel in danger, always, because I know this man, and he could be free because the law says if he doesn't present a high risk for the security of the public, let him free. You believe he's sick or he's not sick, he killed two children, okay? What was the weakness in your personality that made you kill two children?
If Dr. Gaston was frightened by the possibility of freedom for Guy Turcotte, the public and politicians were worried too after a series of horrifying cases put the issue in the national spotlight. In 2011, there was Richard Kashgar, who walked out of a psychiatric hospital in Toronto, commandeered a snowplow, and ran down and killed police officer Ryan Russell. He didn't get jail, but more treatment. When Kashgar was found not criminally responsible, Sergeant Russell's wife was stunned.
Everyone is very disappointed that we're heartbroken. I believe that Ryan deserved a lot better than this.
And perhaps the most notorious case of all. On the Trans-Canada Highway, a couple of hours outside Winnipeg in the summer of 2008.
There we go, we are recording. So, I'm on the Greyhound bus.
On board a bus from Edmonton were 25-year-old carnival worker Tim McClain, heading home. And an unemployed 40-year-old named Vincent Lee, a new Canadian citizen. Not unlike some of the other cases we've told you about. These were two very different people who'd never met, whose lives were about to change forever. This dramatization is based on what happened that night. It wasn't far west of Portage la Prairie that Vincent Lee decided to change seats. He began to move slowly down the aisle.
He looked at every single person as he walked down before sitting down at the final spot that he did. I could feel that something was going to happen. I just didn't know what.
Stephen Allison was seated in a row towards the rear when Lee sat down across the aisle from him and right next to Tim McClain. Just seconds after Allison first caught a glimpse of the knife, Lee suddenly began stabbing McClain.
I was yelling at the top of my lungs, "Stop the bus, someone's getting stabbed." It had been about 50 or 60 times. There was no hope of anything. Like, it's very, very sad, but there was nothing anyone could have done.
In 2009, after a lengthy assessment, the court ruled Vincent Lee suffered from paranoid schizophrenia. He would not be held criminally responsible, however gruesome the killing. Since that verdict, Lee has been housed at a mental health center outside Winnipeg, where he's been described as an ideal patient. By law, his condition is reviewed each year. If and when he's found to be recovered, he could be released with no conditions and no criminal record. It's why Tim McLean's mother, Carol Dedelli, says she's kept fighting to toughen NCR legislation and to keep Vincent Lee in custody as long as possible.
He should be held responsible for it. He still did it. Whether he was in his right frame of mind or not, he still did the act. There was nobody else on that bus holding a knife, slicing up my child.
When we come back, Ottawa vows to crack down on NCR.
With the Not Criminally Responsible Reform Act, our government seeks to protect its citizens and maintain their trust.
But critics say the new law would serve neither the public nor the offenders.
It's a knee-jerk response to a few high-profile cases and the desire to try and look as though we're being tough on crime.
It was a crime that shocked the nation's capital. Former NHLer turned local TV star Brian Smith gunned down by someone he had never met. But a decade later, in 2006, Smith's killer, Jeffrey Arenburg, was a free man. The review board that monitors not criminally responsible cases in Ontario ruled he no longer posed a public threat and ordered him released with just one condition, no guns. Apart from that, whether he got therapy or took medication would be left up to him.
My life has been in limbo since Brian has died.
Year after year following her husband's death, Alana Keynes attended Arenberg's reviews, eventually with her new family. When the board made its final ruling to release him from custody and treatment, she says she couldn't believe her ears.
And I left there and I was like, where was I? What just happened? Why are they doing this? Why can't they just have a social worker check on him once a month? Why not?
As she had all along, she told the review board she believed Arenburg just wasn't ready for the outside world.
I don't understand why. You know, like, we have people in our prison system mm-hmm. who did horrible things, and they're going to be in prison for the rest of their lives. And then because somebody's mentally ill, we're just going to say goodbye to them after. It's a 7-year rule. Just goodbye. You know, it's just not fair. It's not fair to them. It's not fair to the families. It's not fair to the society, the community.
Indeed, about a year after he got out of custody, he got himself into trouble again. On a bus trip to Buffalo, New York, he assaulted an American border agent and served 2 years in a U.S. federal prison. Last winter, stopped for speeding in Quebec, he fled and was arrested. In court, he called the judge an idiot and served 6 months in jail for contempt. With Turcotte and Lee and Kashgar, it was a confluence of controversial NCR cases that the federal government couldn't ignore. Last year, Justice Minister Peter McKay announced new legislation, then known as Bill C-54, to toughen the section of the criminal code that covers the subject of NCR.
With the Not Criminally Responsible Reform Act, our government seeks to protect its citizens and maintain their trust while not stigmatizing mental illness or barring treatment.
The changes create a high-risk category of NCR offenders who would face a longer period of mandatory treatment in custody, at least 3 years between reviews instead of one now. And that high-risk status would be determined not by psychiatrists or review boards, but by a judge.
I think it's a sad reaction.
Montreal psychiatrist Dr. Louis Morissette.
They should make policies using science and what is available from a scientific point of view. And labeling someone who has done what is called a brutal crime, necessarily a high-risk individual, is not scientifically valid.
Because for all the headlines about NCR cases in recent years, according to mental health experts, only a relative handful of those accused of violent crimes in Canada avoid jail time by being designated not criminally responsible.
The population has the perception that there's more and more people using not guilty by reason of mental illness. It's not true. The rate for violent crime is about 0.5%. Less than half of a percent of offenders use that route, are found not criminally responsible.
The bigger issue is one that's totally ignored by the proposed law, which contains no conditions for NCR offenders after they're finally released.
This legislative initiative is not founded on any science or any statistical evidence whatsoever.
Lawrence Greenspan is an Ottawa defense lawyer who you might expect to support more liberal release conditions. In fact, just the opposite. He says the government proposal misses the point that the best way to truly safeguard society is to monitor offenders for a much longer time.
That really is the issue. To what extent can a society ensure that an individual who clearly needs medication and treatment, to what extent can we force that, monitor it, ensure that they get that treatment, and for how long? Because ultimately, even if somebody goes to a mental health facility for 10, 15, 20 years, at some point, they're going to get out.
Which takes us back to Jeffrey Arenburg. Now in his late 50s, he insists he's no longer haunted by the voices that triggered his problems in the first place.
I don't hear them in the background anymore. So when you're diagnosed with a mental disorder, like I was, which is paranoid schizophrenia, that's what they labeled me, don't mean that you always have that paranoid schizophrenia the rest of your life, whether you take pills or you don't. Because, right?
Actually, that's not right. Schizophrenia is considered to be a lifelong medical condition, though controllable with the right drugs. Unfortunately, Arenburg insists now that he's a free man, he has the freedom to decide whether to take medication, too.
So when they discharged you, they left it up to you to make the decision about medication?
Yeah. And I'm not on medication because of my disposition. Says it's up to me to take olanzapine if I think I need it. And I got to restrain from firearms. That's what's on my disposition when I left the mental health center up there.
And in fact, for all the light and heat focused on the subject of NCR by the federal government, after someone like Jeffrey Arenburg is released, crucial decisions about therapy and drug treatment are effectively left up to him, and nothing in the proposed legislation would change that. Alana Keynes was shocked when we told her the man who killed her husband is no longer following any drug treatment.
We understand, speaking to him now, and Bridgewater, Nova Scotia, that he doesn't take medication. He says he doesn't take medication.
That scares me. That's hurtful, and that tells me that he doesn't care what he'd done.
When we return, life after NCR for a troubled man and an anxious town.
Basically, it is a small town. People know who he is and know what he's done. So they're concerned, yeah, absolutely.
Today, Jeffrey Arenberg's life has come full circle, back to his roots on the south shore of Nova Scotia, in the town where he was born. Finally home after decades in and out of psychiatric and correctional facilities. But in a community of several thousand, it's hard to blend in. Especially for someone with Arenberg's past. Police Chief John Collier.
There's definitely concerns out there. Taking someone's life is still one of the big taboos in our society. And basically, You know, it is a small town. People know who he is and know what he's done. So they're concerned. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Do you feel that that's how you're living now, Jeff?
I'm living under the thumb, yeah.
Blame it on the past or paranoia. Arenburg says all too often in public he feels he's being watched and judged, as if tattooed with those three letters, NCR. The police chief doesn't disagree.
That goes to the public perception of him. And he's, to some degree, he's not wrong. There is a stigma attached to being NCR.
Mitchell building here.
Jeffrey Arenberg's world must seem to be closing in, as one by one there are places in his hometown he's no longer allowed to go, because he can be excitable and loud.
Here's a copy of Community Services, yeah.
And he's got the pile of paper to prove it. Correspondence and restraining orders barring him from the Department of Motor Vehicles and the provincial office which deals with his disability check.
I'm getting slapped in the face, trying to be a civilized person, whether I take pills or see a psychiatrist. That got nothing to do with my personal case.
I can hear your frustration, and it's obvious, and yeah, well, okay. I can see that you've got...
Like, even from some of the questions...
Some specific questions.
Even from... I get the observation by some of your questions, you still think I'm paranoid schizophrenic.
Well, it's not for me to judge that, but I do want to know if you still think you're a paranoid schizophrenic.
Well, because this is like I learned, and they taught me in a mental hospital to be this way. And then all of a sudden I get this bullshit and I'm doing the same thing?
Yeah.
Am I paranoid schizophrenic? What do you think?
Honestly, I don't know. I have no way of knowing.
Well, then what do I do?
He seems especially frustrated he hasn't been able to get a business going, though he earned a college diploma, bought a license, and registered a name, Arenburg Consulting.
How am I going to get paid a rent? How am I going to eat? How am I going to do this? How am I going to find out this? And then it wears on you. And then you still got to do the walk of life, and after you get slapped in the face so many times, what do?
I asked, does he wonder if things might actually be better had he never been found NCR in the first place?
You believe that? That had you gone to prison for Brian Smith's death, it would be different?
You know where I'd be? In jail. So you want me in jail? Throw me in jail. I haven't got the authority anyway. Yeah. So as far as I'm concerned, to you for that comment.
Would you feel better if he were on medication?
I personally would. We have a system where we don't really force people to do that, to take medication.
And that's the crucial point. Because however tough on crime the federal government wants to be seen to be, its proposed changes to the not criminally responsible law do nothing to alter the fact that NCR offenders who are released have no mandatory aftercare, either treatment or medication, once they're back on the streets. Yet it's one thing on which many of those disparate voices agree, from families of victims to law enforcement and the medical and legal communities.
Montreal psychiatrist Louis Morissette was on the panel that made the controversial recommendation to release Guy Turcotte after he killed his children. But surprisingly, even he argues there should be a legal mechanism for long-term treatment.
If you're found not criminally responsible, you will be under supervision for a minimum amount of time, not in hospital, but in supervision for 10 years, 15 years for homicide. I would agree with that. It's a breach of liberty, yes, but that goes with being found not criminally responsible.
Ottawa defense lawyer Lawrence Greenspan is a longtime civil liberties advocate, but he too believes, whatever the role of the Charter of Rights and Freedoms, there must be some way to require continuing scrutiny for NCR offenders who are released.
Ultimately, I think it's going to come down to, would you be prepared in very serious cases, in murder cases and things of that nature, would you be prepared to look at that person being followed and having to check in once every week or once every 2 weeks, effectively for the rest of their life, in order to ensure that the safety of the community?
Jeffrey Arenburg says he no longer hears voices, but he maintains the voices he once heard and the radio transmission of his thoughts were real, and he still appears to believe they justified killing Brian Smith.
Before I pulled the trigger, like I just discussed, other people hearing the same voices, so were they all crazy too?
After several hours we spent together, there seemed few signs of reflection or remorse. Certainly no commitment to resume therapy or medication. In fact, 7 years after his release, there was little at all with which to judge how much, or even if, Jeffrey Arenburg has changed.
If Alana Keynes, Brian Smith's wife, were sitting here instead of me, what would you like to say to her?
What could I say? I can't change yesterday. It don't matter if I bawl my eyes out, apologize to the end of the world. I can't change what happened yesterday or 18 years ago or 20 years ago. I can't change that. It don't matter what I do.
If you were in the same situation now that you were then, would you do the same thing again?
You see, now there's asking me a question that I was already found out criminally responsible of, and how can I answer that? Being truthful and honest.
You could be truthful and honest.
Because I can't predict the future. Can you?
No.
There you go.